So you've been working for days, weeks, months maybe, on creating the perfect application. You've got it running on your computer, everything works, and you are ready to make this available to the internet. What does that process look like? And specifically in this video, I'm going to talk about what happens when you're deploying a database-driven application. What do I mean by that? I mean, you have an application that runs some code and talks to a database. That's really most applications on the internet. Not everything, but we're going to talk about what happens when you deploy a database-driven application. The first thing you need to do, write code that works on your machine. And what that involves typically is writing in some sort of programming language. It might be Node.js, it might be Python, it might be C#, it doesn't matter what programming language it is. You've got to write your code. And then you might connect that code to a database. In our example here, I'm going to be using Postgres. It doesn't matter what database you use, the concepts are all the same. Just substitute MySQL or SQL Server or whatever it is that you are using here. The principles are the same. So you've got your code, your application code that is talking to a separate program, the database that's storing your information. And then you've got your code that connects those two, some sort of connection between the code and the database. And to do that, you have to do some stuff to the database to prepare it to receive data. When you just set up a database, it's empty. You might want to do something like create table people if you want to store information about people in your database, or whatever it is. And different programming languages do this differently. Some might have what they call database migrations, where the code writes to the database and creates the tables in the database. Either way, you've got to do stuff on this database so that it's ready to receive the information that your code wants to give it. That's great. Now you've got code that works on your machine. The next step is that you want to put that code on an application cloud server. I might use some AWS examples here, but again, it doesn't matter whether you're deploying to AWS or something else. You just need a place in the cloud to put your code, a server somewhere out on the internet where people from everywhere else can get to it. And we're going to take that Node.js code, we're going to put it up on that application server. Great, we've got an application server. In our case, I'm going to use examples of Elastic Beanstalk. They set up a little server for you, and that is running your code. That's awesome, fantastic, wonderful. There's still something we need to do though. We need to get your database up there, because just having your code running on your machine is great, but you need that database to run it. So in our case, being on AWS, we're going to use RDS, and we're going to set up RDS to run Postgres. So the same program that was running on our computer running Postgres, now we're going to have a database running in the cloud, running Postgres. Fantastic. RDS is the name of the service that runs that for you on AWS. Again, every cloud provider has one. You can find their relational database service, whatever it's called, and run your server there. Wonderful. There's still a step missing. Well, there's that. We got to write our connection code. So when you're developing purely locally, you might have had code that said, connect to the database on localhost port 5432, because that's Postgres's port, or 3306 if it's MySQL, or whatever SQL Server port is, and with the username and the password and whatever it is that you set up here on this database. Here, it's a different username. It's a different password. It might be a different database name, and it's not running on localhost port 5432 anymore. Now it's running on a different server, on a completely different machine. So you've got to set up your Node.js or Python or whatever code that you have running to talk to whatever database is over here. And you've got to set it up so that maybe it can possibly work in both environments and not just one of them. And once you've done that, you've got your connection to the database. We're still missing something. What is that something? We are missing the tables. We've set up the database. The database is there, but it doesn't have any tables in it. Just like when we set it up here, it didn't have any tables. When we set it up here, it doesn't have any tables. So we've got to do our create table to make it work. Just like you ran it create table to create a table on your local database, now you need to run create table on your remote database to make that function. If you don't have a table there, your code's going to say, hey, Postgres, send me all the information from the table people. And Postgres is going to respond and say, I've never heard of the table people in my life. And so we need to set that up. We need to run that code. So an overview. These are the steps. You got to write code that works on your machine first, deploy that code to the cloud, make a cloud database for that code that's running in the cloud to connect to, Then you connect your code to the cloud database and then recreate your tables in that cloud database. Easy peasy. Once you've got that up, you've got an application that's up and running. And that's great at first, but it doesn't stop there. You have to keep going. Maybe you want to add a new table. Maybe you want to add the table, add a new column. In this case, we're adding the column birth date. And in our local development environment, we're working on our code, we're working away. We add a new column to the database. That's great, that's wonderful. We have the birth date now and our code can talk and receive information about the birth date. And that's great. But guess what? That's not the end. Because just like we had to run create table on here and on here, we have to run alter table on here and on here. So just when we update our code, we're gonna send a new version of our code to Elastic Beanstalk to run or whatever you're running your code. When we run database migrations or database alterations, database changes, adding columns, adding tables, deleting things, whatever it is that you're doing, you need to run those in the cloud as well. And you need to run those on your cloud database, wherever that happens to be. Because your code is now expecting birth date to be there. And until you tell this database that birth date needs to be there, it's not gonna be there. So that's about all you really need to know. That's the basics. I'm gonna give a couple specific Elastic Beanstalk tips. Because Elastic Beanstalk is kind of its own little thing and every platform is gonna have its own quirks and tips. So if you're not using Elastic Beanstalk, these aren't necessarily going to apply, although there might still be useful things to learn from here. Some Elastic Beanstalk specific tips. Specifically, that when you set up an application in Elastic Beanstalk, it creates what is called a reverse proxy. So you deploy your code, whatever code that is, Node.js or whatever code it is, it doesn't matter. This could be Python, this could be Node.js, this could be .NET, doesn't matter. The code is running, and it's running very much like it's running in your local environment. It's running on some port, port 3000 in your local environment, some port that's specified by the Elastic Beanstalk configuration in the cloud, and that code is just running, and it's listening for traffic on localhost. And the reason it's doing that is because we set up a reverse proxy. You don't do it, Elastic Beanstalk does it for you. There's lots of good reasons for this. Reverse proxying is good or best behavior in the context of a deployed application because Nginx or Apache as reverse proxies can do some stuff really well, like adding HTTPS encryption, and they're just really good at handling those external HTTP connections. So we have Nginx running as a reverse proxy, meaning you've got a web server here that's listening on port 80, and if you add HTTPS on port 443, and that's what is connecting to your browser. So when you open up your browser and type, you know, whatever your domain is and hit enter, you are talking to Nginx. When Nginx receives that request, it forwards that to the code, whatever code is you have passed it, whatever code is running in the background. What this environment means is that you might get sometimes you'll get some cryptic errors that are a little bit harder to understand than what you might see if you're working in your local environment. So what are those errors? The biggest one is going to be the 502 bad gateway. What that means is that you don't have any errors in the deployment part of the script, at least as far as Elastic Beanstalk was able to determine, but you do have some errors in your code. It means Nginx is running. You've got Nginx right there that says Nginx is working, but when Nginx tries to forward a request onto your Node.js application, there is something wrong. So this part of the connection works great. This part of the connection, not so much. And we need to take some steps to fix that. And the way to find what's wrong is with the logs. Logs, in the case of cloud applications in general, are your friend, because that is where you find errors. You don't often have, sometimes you have a console where you can see errors, but very often if those errors are happening on the back end, you don't have a console on the front end that shows that information. All of that's running on the back end. You need to look for those errors in the logs, and there's a couple errors specifically for Elastic Beanstalk that are helpful. Var log ebengine.log is for when the build fails. When there's something wrong in your instructions to Elastic Beanstalk for how to run your application, you're going to get some stuff there in ebengine.log. That says, and that, if you dig around, if you look down, typically you want to look at the bottom of the log, or the bottom of that section of the logs, because that's the most recent stuff. Look for something about the build failing. And that's where you're gonna see that. There's another section, var log webstandardout.log, is where you will see programming errors. That is the console where your programming errors show up. So if you're, you know, doing stuff in Node.js, where you, it, you know, when you're developing locally and you see the little error message down in the console where you're running your application, var log, web standard out.log is where those show up. And if you want to really get into it, you can make your own custom logs. You can set up and create your own logs to show up in that, and you can log whatever information about your application that you want. So that, roughly, is deployment. The important thing to remember, deployment's always harder than you think it should be. It starts, you know, you think, ah, millions of people have put up millions of applications millions of times, but there's always problems, there's always issues, there's always something specific to your code that doesn't quite work right, and so just start early, deploy often, and set up a good deployment process, get comfortable with it, because you're gonna have to kind of troubleshoot these errors and figure things out. But if it's any comfort, remember, millions of people have deployed millions of applications on the internet, so even though it's harder than you think it should be, it's definitely possible, and you can get it done. I believe in you.